parada? Muito bem. Hi everybody, today I have a special guest with me, my daughter Mafalda, nickname Muffy. And well, the stage is with her.
Hello, I'm Mafalda. Today I'm going to talk to you about a very interesting topic. What metabolisms are behind the famous glucose curve? This episode is a little bit of my story, because when I was smaller, my glucose curves were catastrophic. First, I will quickly explain the concept of the glucose curve. So, what is glucose? Glucose is our body's main source of energy. We get most of it from the food we eat, and it is then transported into our bloodstream and then into our cells. Its concentration can fluctuate wildly throughout the day, and sharp increases in this concentration, the so-called glucose spikes, affect everything, from our mood, to our sleep, to our weight, our skin, and even the health of our immune system. It is unlikely that you have heard about glucose unless you have diabetes. But glucose really does affect us all. In recent years, certain tools have been made available to better monitor this molecule. They are called CGMs, or continuous glucose monitors. The first time I saw one of these was in my father's arm, and it was monitoring throughout the day his levels of glucose. These small devices were created to replace the finger pricks that people with diabetes have been using for decades. But these only give glucose measurements a few times a day. With a CGM, glucose levels are measured every minute, so all glucose curves are very easy to know and to track. We have understood the importance of this glucose curve and that there are tools to measure it, but today I will explain what actually happens behind a glucose spike. Let's start by looking at the example of drinking a can of soda, which contains about 30 to 40 grams of sugar. This sugar can be either glucose in the form of syrup or sucrose, either in the form of cone fructose or sugarcane syrup. The body of an adult contains about 5.5 liters of blood. If said individual has glucose levels rounding 90 milligrams a liter, there is roughly around 5 grams of sugar in his blood. When we drink a can of soda, in just 5 to 10 minutes, we blast 40 grams of sugar into our blood, which is 8 times the total amount of sugar in our whole blood. All the excess sugar ingested cannot stay in our bloodstream, and it so has to be metabolized. In a first stage, it gets into our cells, and here, insulin plays a big role of prompting the cell membranes to absorb this excess sugar in our blood. This is called the natural regulation mechanism. The problem occurs when people drink soft drinks too often and replace water with them, and then eat highly processed and refined wheat flour-based foods such as bread, pizza, cookies, sweets, etc. These diets exhaust the body, and as a result, the cells stop accepting more glucose, closing their membranes and no longer responding into insulin. And this is what we call insulin resistance. In this situation, the pancreas is forced to produce more insulin to try to overcome all this cell resistance. The state of hyperinsulinemia, that is, high levels of insulin in the blood, induces a radical change in the metabolism of the liver. The liver is a key organ in detoxifying the body. However, under hyperinsulinemia, it leaves that function behind and takes on the role of converting excess blood sugar into fat instead. The liver is also responsible for storing the sugar in fat deposits, the adipose tissue, and even in the liver itself, also known as hepatic lipid infiltration or fatty liver. This type of situation progressively induces a certain automatism in the liver and the lipid tissue, which enter into an accelerated process of anabolism, that is, cellular growth, whilst the rest of the organism enters catabolism, that is, degeneration. It is for this reason that fat mass gain always means catabolism or degeneration of the body, regardless of the clinical situation, such as changes in blood tests, hypertension, and diabetes. An individual with insulin resistance already has significant metabolic changes regardless of their blood glucose level. That is, the liver and pancreas are highly active to process the blood load of sugars, increasing in the storage of fat in the body, both in the vessels and in the adipose tissues. Back when we only consumed whole grain products, the so-called chyme progressed along the intestine, and the nutrients gradually entered the circulation and were absorbed by the cells with little insulin demand, which required little effort of the parts of the body. The organism is designed with the ability to capture nutrients without much need for insulin to open up the cell membrane, so that glucose can pass into the cells. For highly processed meals, we don't actually need much more than the initial part of the intestine, as full absorption happens in less than half of the meter of the intestine. The blood isn't able to manage such quick overload of nutrients, which leads to pancreatic stress. The human body was not designed biologically for an ongoing glucose imbalance. Please remember this.
Amazing, Mufalda. Thank you. Amazing presentation. And hello, everybody. So still on the subject of diabetes, today I have a special guest with me, Dr. Pedro Carrillo. Dr. Pedro is a family medicine physician and member of the Portuguese Society of Diabetology. Hi, Pedro.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us and welcome to the Nuranina Academy.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
So starting from the premise that oxidative stress is widely recognized as being associated with various disorders, including diabetes, and at the same time, hydrogen, it is well established as a reductive agent. Today, what we are going to discuss is a possible alternative to controlling diabetes, correct?
Yes, Rita, correct. And today I bring you a study where the authors investigated the effects of hydrogen-rich water intake on lipid and glucose metabolism in patients with either type 2 diabetes or impaired glucose tolerance. They performed a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled crossover study in 30 patients with type 2 diabetes and 6 patients with impaired glucose tolerance, controlled by diet and exercise.
Pedro, sorry to interrupt you. I just wanted to remind our audience that randomized controlled trials, such as this case, have high scientific evidence and quality, because when we are looking at scientific studies, it's very important to take into consideration the quality of the evidence. Right?
Yes, these are the gold standard of studies, the top of the pyramid. And in this study, several biomarkers of oxidative stress, insulin resistance, and glucose metabolism, assessed by an oral glucose tolerance test, were evaluated at baseline and at 8 weeks.
Mm-hmm. And what results did they get?
So the intake of hydrogen-rich water was associated with significant decreases in the levels of modified low-density lipoprotein, the so-called LDL cholesterol, by 15.5%, and also decreasing the small dense LDL, which are the most dangerous ones, by 5.7%. Also decreasing the urinary azoprostanes by 6.6%.
Wow, amazing results.
Yeah, and more also. The supplementation with hydrogen-rich water intake was also associated with a trend of decreased serum concentrations of oxidized LDL mm-hmm. and free fatty acids, but also an increase of the plasma levels of adiponectin and the extracellular superoxidismutase, which is a very powerful antioxidant. Also, in 4 of 6 patients with impaired glucose tolerance, the intake of hydrogen-rich water normalized the oral glucose tolerance test.
Okay, amazing. So, in conclusion, these results suggest that supplementation with hydrogen-rich water may have a beneficial role in prevention of type 2 diabetes and insulin resistance. Pedro, as a physician, it is something that you plan to use on your in your clinical practice?
Yes, with no doubt. It's something I've been applying for the last year using the CellPower Water Bottle. And I think as physicians, well, we always have to look for safe and effective solutions for our patients, especially these non-pharmacological therapeutics with no adverse effects. And of course, always with scientific evidence and common sense hand in hand. And I'm really keen and hoping we can have here a great tool to help us fight the diabetes in the future.
Me too. Thank you, Pedro. It was a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
We hope to see you on the next topic.
Of course.
And that's all for today. Thanks for joining us, and we hope to see you soon. Bye-bye. Thanks for watching.